Ladies and gentlemen, before we resume, we have just received the news that the former Belgian Prime Minister Wilfried Martens has died, a great European, and we would like to pay our respects to Commissioner de Gucht, his countryman, and to all the Belgian people. This was to be the crowning moment of this 2 days conference on overcoming obstacles to growth. As it is, in the event, it's only three quarters of a crowning moment, because some jewels in the crown are missing. Our friends from, as the British say, from across the pond. As you all know, the US government is in a state of shutdown, and yesterday at the dinner, there was a social occasion, I made some lighthearted remarks on the fact, but in the cold light of the day, it is a no-laughing matter. All the participants in the first panel this morning have agreed that a successful TTIP, or TTIP as some call it, is essential to the continuing prosperity of both Europe and the United States. So we sincerely hope that our partners in the United States will soon get their act together, and we can get the talks back on the track. It's not just an issue of immense economic importance. It is a geopolitical issue as well, with the Doha round really not going anywhere. This is one of the crucial round of talks, but as you all know, it's not the only game in town. And if we can't agree to be the standard setters for the foreseeable future, others will. But after all I've said, we're still having a stellar panel, if I may say so, and we immensely appreciate that the EU Commission for Trade, Karel de Gucht, took the time to be with us today. Thank you, Commissioner. We have my current boss, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Czech Republic, Jan Kohout. We have Malcolm Harbour, who's the chairman of the Committee on Internal Market and Consumer Protection of the European Parliament. And we have Peter Chase, who's the Vice President of the Chamber of Commerce of the United States. And to have a really global panel, we have Kojiro Shiojiri, the ambassador of Japan in the European Union. And the whole panel will be moderated by a colleague and friend of mine, the First Deputy Foreign Minister, Jiří Schneider. Jiří.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. You made my job easier, because you already introduced all the speakers. So because we are behind a time schedule, and for the sake of good debate, I would like to ask Commissioner de Gucht to take the floor. I think we can expect, Commissioner, that it will not be just the contribution of the panelists, but we expect a substantial contribution, more substantial contribution. So hence, I call you to the pulpit, because we expect a comprehensive view from the from Brussels. And once again, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Mr. Schneider,
Minister,
President,
dear colleague of the European Parliament, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, I'm very pleased to be here in the Czech Republic, and I'm very pleased to be here as a guest of the Aspen Institute, an institution that has contributed over many decades to the intellectual basis for policymaking both in America and in Europe. The fact that the Institute has no less than six branches here in Europe shows the seriousness with which you take the transatlantic relationship. And I agree with you, the transatlantic relationship is a very serious matter indeed. In fact, it's the most successful commercial partnership that the world has ever seen. The energy it injects into our economies is measured in the millions, billions and trillions of job, trade and investment flows. That means that the transatlantic trade and investment partnership is also a serious matter. Because what we are trying to do with the TTIP is to squeeze even more energy, juice, out of the transatlantic relationship to fuel our economies. Luckily, there is quite a lot of energy available. If we are ambitious and we reach a comprehensive agreement, we could see a growth boost for Europe in the region of 120 billion euros and an increase in the US economy of around 90 billion. That would likely translate into millions of new jobs for our workers. And the best thing about the energy we would create through an effective TTIP is that it would be renewable, because the way trade liberalization works is that it permanently increases the amount of wealth that an economy can produce. So these billions of euro wouldn't be a one-off gain, but one that continues every year. The challenge, though, is to do a deal that effectively makes it easier to do business on both sides. Unfortunately, that's not a straightforward prospect, because we have already, over the past 60 years, through the multilateral system, removed a great many barriers to transatlantic trade and investment. So all of the relatively easy work is gone. There is no low-hanging fruit. What remains are the toughest issues. True, there are some low tariffs which would be relatively easy to remove, like the 3.5% duty that Czech tire exporters pay into the US Treasury. But many more of the other areas, like procurement barriers in US states, for instance, will be anything but easy. And the most complicated area of all, regulatory barriers to trade, is what I would like to talk about today. Regulatory barriers are more complicated to remove than traditional trade barriers because they are not supposed to be trade barriers at all. The main purpose of a tariff is clearly to make imports less competitive. But a regulation's primary goal is to achieve public policy goals, like the protection of health, safety, financial security, or the environment. That goal is an important one, which is why both our governments have gone to so much trouble to build up complex systems of regulatory protection. But, intentional or not, regulation often also comes at a price for interest. For international trade in particular. Regulations can block goods from entering a market by declaring them unsafe, for instance. Or they can make important products more expensive by adding additional costs incurred by industry to meet different regulations and standards. Sometimes we have to pay this price in order to have high levels of protection. Sometimes, but certainly not always. Regulations in different countries can be different simply because regulators weren't aware that there were other ways to solve the problem they were facing, or because they had based their analysis on different scientific data, or because some domestic businesses actually press for regulations to exclude foreign products from their markets. We do not have to accept these differences. They can be avoided in future regulation through early dialogue, and for existing rules we can find ways to recognize what our different approaches have in common. Of course, the complexity of the systems, the traditions of regulators, and occasionally the entrenched interests behind them make this very challenging. But I am confident that TTIP will make a real, measurable difference. Why? Well, because this is not the first time that this has been done, and we in the European Union have deep experience of how to do it. After all, what is a single market if not the world's most advanced, most revolutionary experiment in regulatory cooperation? The rules that underpin it hold together 28 countries with different languages, different legal and regulatory cultures, and different levels of economic development. Of course, we should be under no illusion. The TTIP will not create a single market between the EU and the US. Neither is this the objective. But we can use our experience of the single market to support us as we work on TTIP, at least in three ways. First, the single market provides perhaps the highest level of consumer, environmental, and labor protections in the world. EU regulations adopted more and more by countries around the world, not just because they want to sell their products to our market, but also because our approaches are often taken as the gold standards for achieving certain public policy goals, such as clean air, clean water, or more safety for consumer products and the like. There doesn't need to be a trade-off between high standards and open markets. Second, the single market is a system where goods and services that comply with European regulations can be sold anywhere across a market of 500 million consumers. Once you get a product approved in one country, you can sell it anywhere in the whole of the Union. No national regulations can block its free movement. The EU approach to standards also facilitates free movement. One of the major successes of the EU system is that we have done away with conflicting standards. Once an agreement is reached at European level, national standards bodies must withdraw all existing national standards. This is obviously very important for European producers, but it also makes accessing the European market much easier for our trading partners. The TTIP needs to take up this effective market access approach. Finally, the EU system manages to do all this while still being open and transparent. Just take our legislative process. Before the Commission even makes a proposal for legislation to Council and to the European Parliament, it carries out a comprehensive impact assessment based on wide consultation of anyone who will potentially be affected. And that includes our trading partners around the world. Indeed, for them, we go even further, because for the regulations with the greatest trade impact, technical regulations and food quality rules, we consult World Trade Organization members and stakeholders on draft texts, and we take the time to respond to their comments. Our standard system is also highly transparent. We develop standards in close collaboration with all interested groups, including industry, consumers' representatives, and anyone else with a stake in our market. We draw from the best science available. We make it very clear from the outset when we are requesting a standard to support public policy objectives. The Commission's mandate to the European standardization organizations is always made public. Our standards developing process feeds directly into global working bodies like the International Organization for Standardization and the International Electrotechnical Commission. And though it takes more effort because there are more people around the table, we support it because it provides the greatest benefits to international trade. The TTIP will also be guided by the principles of openness and transparency, both in its negotiating process and in its provisions on regulatory cooperation. These principles are important, but I know many people are curious as to what we mean in practice when we talk about the regulatory part of TTIP. From the European side, there are three essential elements: ways to cooperate on future regulations to avoid unnecessary trade barriers, ways to make existing regulations more compatible, and supporting this work with the right institutional build-up. First, to have maximum effect or cooperation on future regulations with a significant impact on transatlantic trade should be strengthened across the board, from food safety to financial services. For example, when European and American regulators work on rules that will likely affect the other side of the Atlantic, they need to open channels of information and communication from very early on. Some regulators already have shown excellent cooperation, but a lot more can be done. And TTIP can support this so that in transatlantic cooperation becomes a natural reflex. A similar approach could also apply to standards development organizations. Here too we have some very encouraging examples, like smart grids, electric vehicles, and organic foods. And here too, more cooperation early on would minimize differences and reduce costs. Second, we need to look at existing regulations. How can we make them more compatible, especially in important sectors like automotive, machinery, chemicals, health, financial services, and ICT. In the case of the TTIP, this is particularly important, because if we can't agree to remove individual barriers to trade in particular products, we won't convince anybody that our principles serve a purpose. Let me give you some examples. One is cars, a subject dear to the hearts of many in this country, I know. Nobody seriously doubts that either US or European cars are safe to drive. And yet we have different safety regulations for everything, from headlamps to electric windows. I believe regulators on both sides could formally agree that many of these regulations in fact produce the same level of safety, even if they are not exactly the same. If they could, that would mean that cars and car parts manufacturers would need to comply with two different sets of technical requirements when trading across the Atlantic. The Czech Republic has a lot to gain from this. Last year, the Czech Republic exported around 11 billion euros in car parts. And we know that even if those exports first went to Germany or other European countries, many of those eventually continued onto the US in finished products. In fact, the value of Czech exports to the US goes up by a quarter when we take this kind of trade into account. Another example is pharmaceuticals. The interesting thing about medicines is how much transatlantic regulatory cooperation there already is. By working together, regulators have increased safety and reduced costs dramatically over the last 20 years. But some things are still separate. For example, EU and US authorities both inspect the same pharmaceutical factories to make sure they are up to scratch, even though the good manufacturing practices our inspectors are looking for are the same. If we were able to recognize each other's inspections, we would make things easier for the companies and save governments some money, which would be better spent elsewhere. Chemicals should be another area where we can work together. This is a very different scenario because European and American chemicals legislation is so different. But even here we can still cooperate. There are several important areas like labeling requirements and better coordination of safety assessments, where TTIP could make things more efficient, both for companies and for regulators. Finally, financial services. The financial crisis showed in stark clarity that this is a global sector and that countries need to work together if we are to manage risk effectively. This is particularly true of the EU and the US, given our 70% share of world trade in financial services. And this is why we have both been advocating high international standards for global regulation. Through the G20, the Financial Stability Board and the Basel Committee. And we have been making real progress. But there is a real risk that EU and US authorities implement what has been agreed in inconsistent ways. We have already seen examples of duplication of rules and rules with extraterritorial effects. And this has a cost. It weakens financial resilience and makes it more difficult for our companies, for our economies to recover. So we need to cooperate more to produce better results. And TTIP gives us that opportunity. These are just some of the examples. In these and many other areas, European and American companies have submitted substantial, convincing joint proposals on how to facilitate trade and investments. But I can say to any interested parties in the room that we are ready to look at new, reasonable proposals for cooperation that will facilitate trade while keeping protection intact. The third and final pillar of Europe's vision for the TTIP's regulatory pillar is institutions. Here again, we have learned from the past. If we want regulators to work together in the future, we need to make sure that they are equipped to do so. I therefore propose that the TTIP establishes a new Regulatory Cooperation Council that brings together the heads of the most important EU and US regulatory agencies. The Council would monitor the implementation of commitments made and consider new priorities for regulatory cooperation, also in response to proposals from stakeholders. In some cases, it could also ask regulators or standard bodies to develop regulations jointly that could then have a good chance of becoming international standards. Strong institutions like this will be key to making the TTIP a living agreement that promotes greater compatibility of our regimes and accelerates the development of global approaches. And strengthening global approaches is one of the primary strategic objectives of this agreement. TTIP can support international cooperation on regulatory issues, whether in ISO and IAC for international standards, the UN Economic Commission for Europe for automotive technical regulations, or in the International Medical Device Regulators Forum. We have already seen the potential of a stronger transatlantic partnership in the recent cooperation between the EU, US, Japan, and now China on electric vehicles. When the EU and the US work together, there is a natural multiplier effect that brings benefits both to us and to our trading partners. Before I finish, I want to make three more fundamental points, points that are very important for the people of Europe to understand. First, nothing we will agree under this agreement will lower standards of protection. Removing regulatory barriers is not a race to the bottom. Second, neither side is going to renounce the right to regulate in future to reach the level of protection that their citizens choose. To be very clear from a European perspective, the Commission, Parliament and Member State governments will continue to set the rules. And given that the precautionary principle is enshrined in the Lisbon Treaty, nothing in the TTIP could possibly change that. Third, a beauty contest will flatter no one. Neither side will be successful if it seeks to impose its system on the other. Instead, we should seek to exercise joint leadership on these issues. If we do not, others will. This is our vision for TTIP. It is both ambitious and practical. It will not be easy, but it will be worth it will worth it if we do make the effort. Being here in the Czech Republic, I am very encouraged that we will make that effort. This is a country that takes the transatlantic relationship seriously. The Czechoslovak Declaration of Independence was drafted in Washington, D.C. Anton Dvorak wrote the New World Symphony in New York. There are countless other examples of our of your Atlantic links. But this is a country that also understands what real economic integration can deliver. The Czech Republic has seen the immense benefits of the single market firsthand. Your economy has increased in size by almost a quarter since it joined the European Union in 2004, and by more than half since its first trade agreement with the European Union began working in 1995. Of course, the European Union has also benefited from the Czech Republic's own economic dynamism. If we base our approach on these principles, strengthening the transatlantic bonds while inspired by the single market, we will reach, I have no doubt, a very valuable conclusion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you for outlining the principles of the European approach, and thank you also for custom-tailored remarks on behalf directed to Czech Republic. I think they are coming to a really fertile and prepared soil, as you probably will see from the discussion. So thank you very much. Now, because Ambassador Kojiro Shiojiri has to leave earlier, I ask the permission of the members of the panel that he will be speaking first now, and then we will follow the order of as it is in program. By chance, it is that we are coming from the pulpit back to Commissioner. So, Ambassador, already we have mentioned that this is not just bipolar debate. There are other actors, and you have a wide and deep experience with Brussels from the Japanese perspective. And so we expect from you another perspective on our transatlantic debate. Warm welcome to Prague, and floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I'm very honored and privileged to be here and discuss with you. And this is on TTIP, but I'm very grateful for inviting me to in your dialogue. After Commissioner's very impressive speech, I'm very much afraid to shed cold water, but.
Please do.
Taking advantage of this occasion, I like to touch upon Japan EU EPA, FTA negotiation is underway. And we have also want to conclude comprehensive and high level ambition of agreement. But to conclude and to benefit from the agreement when we conclude it, that is not full answer for us. That is, I mean, for TTIP too. We should connect Japan, EU, EPA, FTA, what TTIP should connect with others. And in this respect, we very much welcome you have very strong, good, comprehensive TTIP, and that is good for us. And through TTIP, we have a closer contact with transatlantic countries. And same thing for Europe. When we conclude Japan EU EPA, then it, through Japan EU EPA or FPA, you can reach, connect with Asia. And for us, now we are not just, I mean, undertaking the negotiation to conclude with the EU, but TPP. And not just with big global economic players, and also with our regional global players. We are under negotiation with 16 Asian regional, I mean, countries, RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement. It comprises 16 countries, including China, India, Australia, and so on. And also, we are undertaking Japan, EU, Korea, FTA. So it shows that how you can use through Japan, EU, EPA. And lastly, I'll mention, as Commissioner Gucht correctly mentioned, the model, role model, TTIP certainly be a model for our model. So today's title of this panel is a boost for the Western economic model. But TTIP is not just mere Western economic model. It is for world economic model for us. And in it, our responsibility is not just to close up main players, but how to engage others in our platform or to follow our model. That's an important thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador. We're sorry you will have to leave, but we'll definitely keep in mind that we are not talking Europe, United States. We're talking in a global perspective. And thank you once again for bringing it to the table. The next speaker will be Peter Chase, Vice President of U.S. Chamber of Commerce. There's some advantage of shutdown that those who are not in administration get some prominence in our conference. And Peter is a former diplomat. He has a Brussels experience, but also a China experience. So I hope you will carry on this Asian perspective into our debate as well, if there will be interest. So Peter, floor is yours.
And thank you very much to the Aspen Institute for inviting me here to join this discussion. It is definitely in my interest in this case that Deputy USTR Miriam Sapiro was not able to come. I would have spoken on the business panel, but I'm happy to represent, I think, not just a US business perspective, but to some extent a US government perspective as well, because I think that there is actually quite a strong unity of views between the U.S. business sector, which I represent as the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and the U.S. government. And I'd like to make three points. The first is TTIP is much more than a trade agreement. The second is that we can do this, and we can do it quickly. And the third is that I believe the Czech Republic stands to be one of the major beneficiaries. And I'll try to elaborate on all three of these very quickly. On the first part, obviously, we're hoping that the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership will be a very ambitious and comprehensive trade agreement. But we, in the chamber, and I believe very strongly in the US government, see it as something more than just that. We see it as a strengthening of the bonds between the United States and the European Union. I think, if I'm not mistaken, right now, TTIP stands to be the first congressionally approved treaty between the United States and the European Union. That is not insignificant. As the European Union has grown stronger, as it's become more integrated between the countries here, it's important that the United States recognize, welcome that, embrace it in concluding an agreement like this. And it goes further than that. The United States and Europe, we talk often about values, but we often say values and we don't really talk about what we mean. We focus on our laws and our economic system are focused on the dignity of the individual. That's how we enshrine things, and that's why we believe in a rule of law. After World War II, the United States and Europe were critically important in creating an international rule of law. Binding us together will do that even more. Further, in this agreement, we expect to explore new areas of new rules of development between the United States and Europe that we actually believe could have a global application. And this goes, I think, to the ambassador's comments, that we, if we can agree on certain disciplines that work between us, it provides a basis then for a broader discussion between the United States, Europe, and others. So this geostrategic aspect of this, of bringing, tightening our relationship, is an extremely important one. Second, in terms of can we, doing this agreement and doing it quickly. There are three major points that I think everyone needs to bear in mind as they look at this agreement, at these negotiations. The first is that this is the first time either the United States or the European Union have negotiated an agreement with an economy as large as itself. I'm sure very few Americans know that the last time I looked at the statistics, the economy of the European Union was actually larger than that of the United States. Many people in the United States tend to think we are the largest market. We are as a single nation. But this is something that I think is very important to think that we are partners in this. The second is that we have an investment-based relationship. That is, US companies have invested over $2 trillion into the European Union, and European companies, companies from the EU, have invested over $1.6 trillion into the United States. This is different. We are us. We had some good examples this morning from General Electric and others where our companies are very highly integrated. We are each other's most important markets, but we are, that's how our companies are organized. They are largely transatlantic companies in many respects, reflecting this investment-based relationship. So the interests that our negotiators are speaking for as they try to reduce barriers to trade are those of companies on both sides. The third is that if we structure this right, I think we can do it quickly. We know each other very well as trading partners. We know the rules. We know what we need to do to liberalize trade in goods in terms of eliminating tariffs, which everyone discounts, but I will tell you, some of our tariffs are high, including with respect to the export of autos from the United States here, or the export of trucks to the United States. Some of them, even while they're low, are significant. There's a company that makes catalytic converters, staying with auto parts, that have very high value materials in them. A 1.5% tariff will change the competitive position of that Belgian firm. So eliminating tariffs alone actually is important and good, but we can do much more than that. Freeing up trade and services will be critical. Services before were not really tradable. You needed to be there to sell a service. Now with the internet, you can sell a service a long, long way away. We will liberalize investment. We will expand opportunities for government procurement. All of these things are fairly straightforward. The people who work for Mr. De Hucht, the people who work for our USTR Froman, they know how to do this. They can write these, actually, I think, quite quickly. The issue that is a little bit more difficult because it's new is this one of regulatory things. And what the agreement will do, in the view of the US Chamber of Commerce, the US business community, would be to create a structure that will turbocharge regulator to regulator cooperation by providing a clear goal of trying to get to this point where our regulations are compatible, by providing tools such as those that the commissioner so eloquently spoke about just now, and providing institutions to guide that. We have had a lot of regulatory cooperation in the past. I've been directly involved in it in my US government work. We will do some more regulatory things during the negotiations, but the agreement will turbocharge it. This will be a living agreement. So you can negotiate the basic agreement quickly, but the benefits, as the commissioner said, will come on from a long time. The third point then for the Czech Republic. Again, the commissioner made the point, but I think that this is very important. Anything like this will boost economic growth in the United States and Europe, that's clear. If you increase economic growth anyway, everyone who's an economic player will be added and will benefit. But there will be both direct trade benefits for the Czech Republic. There will also be, I think, indirect trade benefits, which the commissioner pointed to. Just on the direct trade, again, the internet will be critical. It's interesting how many small and medium-sized businesses will be the primary beneficiary of this. They're the ones who have to fight with different regulations. If we can find ways to make mutual recognition happen, they're the ones that will benefit. And with the internet, companies here who may never have exported to the United States before may find themselves being discovered and being able to export directly to customers in the United States. We will need to do things to free up things like de minimis levels and customs facilitation. This will be an important part of it, but it will allow us to engage and become much closer together, much more integrated. I'm looking forward to it. The US business community is extremely supportive of this, and I think we can do it quickly. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And we bid a farewell to Ambassador this time. Next speaker is Malcolm Harbour, Chairman of Committee on Internal Market and Consumer Protection at the European Parliament, a body which is getting more and more importance in negotiations of such agreements, and a man who is serving in the European Parliament for some time and being at the core of promotion of internal market and free trade. So, Malcolm, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Chairman. And can I just say, first of all, it's a really special pleasure to be here. First time I've been to an Aspen Institute meeting. And also, just to reflect on what a number of my colleagues have said, that certainly in my committee, we have a number of very energetic Czech members of the Parliament who contribute very strongly to internal market policy. And I think it's something that we've seen, not just here, but since 2004, how many politicians, new politicians coming to the European market, have been some of the strongest advocates of making the single market work better. And so I think we are at a really important stage now in this transatlantic discussion. And I'm really delighted that Karel de Gucht, in his really important speech, really made the point that I had in my mind to make, but I just will focus on that very briefly, to say that we do know about dealing with non-tariff barriers in Europe, about the real difficulties of creating a truly effective single market. This is the substance of the work of my committee all the time, whether it's in goods or whether it's in services. And so we have a lot of experience of that, and through the parliamentary engagement that we've set up to support the work the Commission is doing, by getting chairmen of committees together under the leadership of the chairman of the International Trade Committee, Vital Moreira, who is, I think, playing a really crucial role here, that we will be looking and assisting and engaging with this process. And I have to say that the proposal that the Commissioner put on the table this morning about having a regulatory cooperation committee of regulators meeting together, I think is an absolutely crucial step forward. And I'm sorry that my good friend Ambassador Shiojiri is gone, because I have also been very actively involved in the work on the EU-Japan EPA as a member of the European Parliament's delegation to Japan, a country where I personally have done trade with over many years in the car industry. The point I was going to make to him is that we have to have a parallel structure between what is going on with TTIP and what's going on in Japan. Because I think at a regulatory level in Japan, it's proving more difficult for us to get engaged because the Japanese regulatory system is, I think, not quite so responsive. And I made that point forcibly when I was with in Tokyo meeting the Japanese car manufacturers last week. And so I think the first point I draw is really to confirm what others have been saying, is that this work that we're doing on a trade and investment partnership is fundamentally different from anything that we've seen before in terms of a free trade negotiation. And it's going to set up permanent relationships and structures that, if we get them right, are going to help stimulate and develop trade to reduce the unnecessary costs to business of working in this space. I mean, I know this having worked in industry before, but why should we be testing cars, for example, in a very expensive way, crashing them into poles or blocks at different speeds and with different equipment in, when actually we're getting to the stage now that survivability of occupants in a motor vehicle collision up to 50 kilometers or even more is now assured by either regulations. Now, actually bringing those together isn't going to be easy, because it means that the engineers and standard makers on two sides, who for years have developed these ideas about how they should do things, are actually going to need to work with us at a political level to say, do you really need to do this? It's not going to be easy, but therefore I think the political leadership of this process is crucially important. And so that leads into my second point, because I think that, again, the Commissioner echoes what we've been saying very much in Parliament. This is absolutely not a race to the bottom at all. Because, as he said, in many areas, I think, and the reason why the time has come for this agreement, is that as we've been working together in product sectors, whether it's in food, whether it's in cars, or whether it's consumer products, we're continually pushing to make products as safe as we possibly can, to deal with any issues about environmental protection, safety of children, removing toxic chemicals, making emission standards for cars move as close as we can get them to a realistic level. And if you look at the convergence of standards between Europe and the US, it's because we've steadily been working to make cars safer and cleaner. And we've now reached the stage where the gap between them is relatively low. So we're not talking about a race to the bottom. What we're actually talking about, and the gold standard is perhaps a difficult analogy, because is it 18 karat gold, is it 24 karat gold, is it platinum? We're actually talking, though, about those sort of values, which is why one group that we haven't really talked about at all, either in this morning panel or this afternoon, which is getting consumers engaged in this dialogue, is going to be absolutely indispensable. Now, we have already a bad experience in trying to open up trade with what happened to ACTA. And the development of ACTA, which I think was an important agreement for dealing with counterfeiting products at all levels, was finally defeated politically, because there wasn't enough engagement with stakeholders, politicians, and consumers in a very transparent way before we got to making the decision. And this is really crucial. I mean, Karel de Gucht may disagree with me on that, but that is my feeling as someone who was not directly involved but was then asked to make a decision on it. And so consumers and consumer groups in TTIP have to play a crucial role. We have an established transatlantic consumer dialogue, and we're going to have to find ways of stepping that up, because what we don't want is to have a lot of arguments about the standards we should adopt that come from outside the process and late on in the process. Those concerns have to be raised and embedded into the process from the very beginning. And that, I think, is an important role that Parliament can play in actually conducting hearings, working with regulatory bodies, exposing some of the issues involved. So this is not going to be negotiations done behind closed doors. This is going to be public arguments about the best standards that we need for consumers and about dealing with some of the issues involved. Because, and here I move to my closing point about regulatory convergence. The importance, I think, of having a proper structure to this. is that everything we do from now on in my committee, we have to map against TTIP. Because we don't want to be introducing new regulations in Europe for the single market that are going to inhibit what's going on. And there was an important event in Strasbourg yesterday where I voted on, something that almost certainly you will not have noticed, and you may not observe it again. But we approved a single market measure yesterday called the Recreational Crafts Directive. Now, I know about it because I was the rapporteur as well. Unusually, the committee chairman doesn't often get the opportunity to be a rapporteur for a report, but my colleagues felt that this was suitable for me to do, moving from cars to boats. The Recreational Craft Directive, for the first time in anything that we've worked on recently, aligns the emission standards in recreational craft internal combustion engines between Europe and the United States. And that was voted on yesterday. You almost certainly won't have noticed it. It was an evolution of existing regulation. But I just tell you about that because the process has already started. And so if you're a boat manufacturer in the Czech Republic, you'll be able to make a boat to your common European standards, and you'll be able to sell it in the United States. So these are small things like that are great trade agreements made. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It was good to witness a lot of points of harmony between Parliament and Commission. I assume there are also some points of disharmony, but we might come to that later on. Last but not least, my current boss, I mean, your boss should have a last word, so my boss will have a last word in the panel, and then we'll open the debate. Jan Kohout, Foreign Minister of Czech Republic, and also previous ambassador to Brussels, having a large experience in Brussels business before. Jan.
Thank you, Jiří, and first of all, I would like to thank the Aspen Institute Prague for bringing to such a prominent place this issue of TTIPs. Because one of the first steps which I did when I lastly arrived as the minister to the Chernin Palace was that I created and established the post of the special envoy for this trans-American Atlantic partnership. And I'm glad that Mrs. Kuchyňová is today with us because she's my personal envoy in that. The reason for that was very simple in my view, and that's I was all the time very much for the strengthening of the transatlantic partnership in many aspects. Unfortunately, in the past years, it has reduced in the minds of the people just to the security, simple security area. So we were with the United States in Afghanistan in many areas, and this simplification was negative to development in other areas of cooperation. And this is exactly, and because I spent the last three years in a very close to the business, and I had the chance to look from the opposite side, that this is exactly the area of cooperation. So to create and to deepen our cooperation in trade and investments, where the Europeans and, of course, in the Czech Republic can find easily its place, doing right thing, strengthening the transatlantic partnership, being for the benefit of both sides of the continent. And in general, and was already said many times, it's going to establish a regulatory environment for the rest of the world. So it's when we see the leaning of the global economy towards the south or southeast. So I think that there is a historic momentum, a historic opportunity, and maybe even the historic need to start and to cooperate much more, much deeper than in the past. So that's my political, let's say, approach to that from the very beginning. And I am glad, and I take it as a in some way, a political project. We often say that EU is was created as a political project. I think that this is somehow also a political project, not based just on the figures of the So impact studies that analyzes what kind of positive impact it will have on both sides, on the economical, both sides of the Atlantic. But mainly, this process should keep in mind the broader context of what we are doing and what we are promoting. And that's also the reason why I think that the Ministry of Foreign Affairs took the, here in the Czech Republic, took the leadership, and we will keep the leadership in that. Although, of course, closely cooperating with other line ministries and groups and associations involved into the whole process. Because we know quite well already, we made some analysis in which areas there would be the very positive impact. We have the minimum, let's say, growth is about 0.2% of the GDP. The best, let's say, expectations are speaking about 2.6 GDP and tens of thousands of jobs new created. So definitely it will have a very positive impact on our economy. And as from this point, and I'm glad that such a broad audience is today here with us, because it's clear not only to us sitting in the panel, but for a broader society, it's becoming more and more important that what we are talking about, what we are trying to push ahead, and I am glad to hear that also from the United States, the views are this, from the governmental and also from the business community, are the same, that we have the historic opportunity and a responsibility to do this job as early as possible. And we will try, and I am sure that we and the business community here and the government are also looking to the same direction, and glad to hear that is the very close position in the EU institutions in Brussels. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We've heard a lot about need for, there was basically a call for political leadership in this, and a question of time frame of this negotiations. Of course, the parallel with golden standards, I think, might be a bit provocative, because we're probably not talking about engraving status quo regulation, but about the dynamic process of approximation between United States and Europe. And so, before we open to the public, to the questions from the audience, would you like to address this issue? Because I haven't heard too much about this, and maybe it's because we don't want to raise expectations too high as for how quick the negotiations might be. Would you like to comment on this question of political leadership and the time frame of negotiations as you see it now? Commissioner?
It's always dangerous to create expectations in that respect, because all of a sudden a negotiation can take much longer for one single point where you cannot reach an agreement. And that's what we have been going through with Canada, for example. I mean, I hope that in the coming days, if not the coming hours, we have a final agreement, but the agreement has been upheld for about a year on a minor issue. That can happen. It could also happen in our negotiations with the US, so that's very difficult to predict. Now, on the other hand, several of my colleagues said, we know each other, we know what it is about, you know. So there is no reason that we should be discussing on this for years and years. And by the way, it's not because we are discussing between regulators for years and years that you will get to any solution. There will need to be political steering in this. No? Now, having a little bit of experience in politics, it's always very difficult to continue the same level of political steering for a very long period. Once you are in a negotiating mood, you should go quickly, especially when it is difficult and when you need political steering. On the other hand, I believe that without political steering, we will never get there. So there really will need to be political involvement at the level of both parliaments, the Congress and the European Parliament, at the level of the member states, at the level of the trade commissioners and the U.S. trade representatives, and also at the highest level between President Obama, President Barroso, and President Van Rompuy to steer this, unless we are not going to reach anything. The question is this realistic to finalize it before the end of next year? Yes, it is. If you really make the right decisions and you show one of the dearest words in whatever speech is made by the Americans, leadership, you know. If you show leadership, you can do that, yes. There is no reason that you couldn't do it by the end of next year and that you could do it by the end of 2015. There is no good argument for that. Because you will have a part that let's say, is establishing an agreement on tariffs, on industrial products, agricultural products, a number of regulations that are approximated or regarded upon as mutually agreed and mutually valid, but there will also be an important part of a living agreement. And you can do that, yes, in 1 year, provided that you have the will to do so. Now, my very simple reasoning is that if you are really convinced that this could contribute to economic recovery, by the way, on both sides of the Atlantic, then there's no good reason that you would discuss it for years, you know. Then you should do it quickly. So that's the only thing I can say about this. I know that Mike Froman, my counterpart, also wants to go quickly. He says one tank of gas. Now, there is a problem with gas, of course, just like with the gold standard. Gas has become considerably cheaper in the U.S., so they can drive longer with it than we can. Huh? But yes, we will try to do it, and I hope it is possible to do so, because this would really give a kick to the world economy. And let me give you an example standards, you know, whether we could, it's about this gold standard, could you become, let's say, the reference? Yes, we can. Take the example of electric cars. We started this process in the Transatlantic Economic Council with the cooperation of companies on both sides of the Atlantic. Japan, the ambassador just left. They came to sit around the table with us, and now even Chinese are doing that. So if we demonstrate leadership in a number of important standards, we will become the world standard. And I think we should realize, probably you do, that the next big battle in trade, it is a battle about norms, standards, and regulations, you know. It's not any longer about tariffs. This is the defensive approach. The real approach, the one that we should have, is one on norms, standards, and regulations. And the only way to be the world leader in that, and to become the gold standard, is to work together.
I mean, I think that the most important thing that's been achieved with the whole political impetus behind the policy is to actually free the standards makers and the regulatory bodies to get on and start working together. And I mean, a number of us have made the point that that's not going to be an easy process. And actually, I think it will be quite helpful if, now that they have a political framework and an encouragement for us to do that, we let them get on with it for a bit. We don't interfere in that process. We let them decide and work together, because they're the experts after all. Now, I mean, clearly we have to make sure that in terms of public interest and what, you know, whatever will result is going to be about consumer and environmental standards. But I mean, the regulators are very conscious of that anyway. That's their motive. You know, the regulators are there to safeguard consumer interests. So there shouldn't be a conflict of issue there. So in terms of the political timing, while it's not necessarily ideal that we're moving into a phase where there will be European elections and there will be a new commission appointed, I mean, I'm not sure that that process of actually letting the ingredients starting to work together. I mean, it's a bit like making wine or beer. You know, you need a bit of fermentation going on. You need a bit of a catalyst for that, and maybe we have to provide some catalytic activity in those different areas. But there are already a lot of people working on this. So I think we need to, if you like, not to be too worried about it. I mean, politicians are always worried about this, and too many politicians want to interfere in the process. So let's take stock of this, and probably after the elections there will be new teams working on both sides. The other point I want to make about standards is that I didn't in any way want to imply that all the European standards will be the gold standards, far from it. I pick up exactly what Karel de Gucht was saying. I mean, the objective is to have the best possible global standards, and as he says, everybody will come into that. And actually, one of the things that I've talked to Ambassador Shiojiri about is that we have to get some real impetus behind the European-Japanese standards dialogue, because that, in many ways, that's much more difficult, but it's bizarrely more difficult because actually, if you take cars and other areas, that our standards are not that far apart. But my final point about where we really do need to have some serious political discussion is about public procurement. We've just revised all the European rules on public procurement, and I think significantly improved them. There are going to be some new opportunities in there for introducing innovative companies into the public procurement cycle. We had an interesting question about promoting innovation earlier, and let's not forget that part of the core investment issue that Peter was talking about, and I agree with him about that, is encouraging more investment in research and development across the Atlantic, and getting more American and European companies involved in joint research projects. And coming back to Japan, and this is sensitive for me because I just spent the weekend in a big science conference in Kyoto, is that Japan is an extremely weak performer in engagement on European research projects. They rank below Kenya in terms of engagement. And if we're going to make the Japan-Europe Economic Partnership work, we have to dramatically step up the whole investment regime at a Japanese level. So that's a specific task that wasn't on the agenda today, but I will give some notes to Karel de Gucht about it.
Thank you. Peter? Just very quickly, in terms of timelines, deadlines, the business community, and I think both European and American business communities would say, don't want a deadline because we want a good agreement. We need to take the time necessary to get a good agreement. But I agree completely with the commissioner that this is something that we can do quickly. And I do think that it will depend, because we have to remember what it is. When I think of doing something quickly, I say, when do they close the negotiations on the text? That's when they initial. And then, of course, you have to have the legal scrub and the translation and the approval and the ratification. So if we want to create jobs with this and we believe we can, then there is no time to waste. We encourage our officials to be sitting down and doing it as much as possible. I think that although this round of negotiations was called off because you could not send a large number of US government officials to Brussels, I think it's useful for everyone here to know that a lot of discussion does go on between our officials by video conference, by telephone, by email. They're constantly engaged. They don't just wait for these formal rounds to work on this, and that's good. So the quicker they can get it done, the better. And again, I think it's important to know that when we say get it done, the trade negotiators can do so much. Regulators working, as Malcolm was saying, regulators have a duty to protect the consumer, the environment, the health of the people in their jurisdiction. TTIP can help them build a bridge between this body of regulation in the EU and this body of regulation in the US, build a bridge between it so that products that are safe in one market are recognized as being safe in the other. There is no weakening, as the commissioner very eloquently said in his remarks. This is not about weakening or changing domestic regulation. It's about creating a bridge between two mature regulatory systems that are very much under the oversight of our political Congress in the United States, the Parliament and the member states here. And I think that that's important, that the agreement will let those regulators continue to work together. They have an interest in working together because they want to be effective in protecting people. And if they can build a partnership with their transatlantic counterpart, then they can do their job better. They have someone to, in a sense, protect their back, as it were. And I think that this is what will be a critical part of this particular negotiation. It will depend on trust and confidence between our regulatory bodies. That will have to develop, has been developing, but will continue to develop over time.
Well, thank you for raising this point of self-interest of regulators in being in partnership with others. So now I open the floor for brief comments and questions. Michal Mejstrík in the first row here. The mic is coming, I hope. Could you provide a mic, please?
Yeah. And the front.
Here, the first row. First row. Thank you.
Okay. Let me say just briefly two points. Let's start with problem solving. I am supporter of impact assessment, the chairman of this government board. But, you know, we have done at International Chamber of Commerce so-called open market index, which was actually supported by Terry McGraw, the worldwide chairman. And the point is that the G20 countries, it was done for G20 meetings, are actually below the average with openness to the market. So there is a big problem and a big chance for the future to improve the situation. That's starting point. In EU, we have not only TTIP, but also REFIT. TTIP, REFIT, you know. REFIT, it's about the better regulation. I personally attended Edinburgh meeting in 2005 when we had a good discussion with one of your predecessors.